You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. I hope this podcast finds you extraordinarily well. This is our fourth story for the month of July 2023, issue 202. How have you been enjoying the stories thus far? You can always leave us a note if you go to the Clarkesworld Magazine About Us page, and that's clarksworldmagazine.com, and that's Clark with an E. All of our contact information is listed there, so drop us a note. Thank you very much for sending us your feedback. Also, thank you very much for your support. Please go to patreon.com/Clarkesworld to see how you can be a part of this magazine each and every month. We need you. We absolutely need you. So please, if you can afford to do so, patreon.com/Clarkesworld. And if you've already been a subscriber or you've donated a few bucks our way, thank you so much. We can't do it without you. Our story is titled Clio's Scroll. It was by Brenda Clough. Brenda Clough is the first female Asian American SF writer, the first appearing in print in 1984. Her historical novel, A Door in His Head, won the 2023 Diverse Voices Award. Her novella, May Be Some Time, was a finalist for both the Hugo and the Nebula Awards and became the novel Revise the World. Her time travel trilogy is Edge to Center, available at Bookview Cafe. The thrilling adventures of Miss Marion Halcombe, a series of 11 neo-Victorian thrillers, appeared in 2021. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. One. You are an exile. Yes and no. Confined in the narrow neck of the vase, as Medisque's voice was tiny and metallic. An oracle is ambiguous. They considered and rejected terminology galaxy, light speed, time warp, circumpolar orbit. These are not words to say it. Conversation with the Florentine poet was like fencing with sharp swords. A short reply. Of course there are words. The poet was over 40, unused to carrying a burden on a hot day. Around the tall, green flank of the mountain now, and the walls of Sartiano, could at last be seen. Every village in Tuscany stood on a height. The Romans, via Cassia, wound uphill, dusty white in the westering sun. Their antique vase, round-bellied, two-handled, and narrow-necked, must weigh heavy in the sling over his shoulder. The poet's voice was strong yet supple, the weapon in the hand of a master. If not in Latin, then in the common tongue. I wrote an entire treatise on the subject. Words are the sign, the very breath of the soul. If you could not speak, you would be nothing but a strange animal that lives in a jug. Their eye strip, imperceptible at the pottery rim, took in the droplets of sweat at the back of the poet's neck. The rolled cappuccino on his head and the sleeveless lucco were wool. I regret my house is so heavy. Ettore is young, and he complains, carrying it. His complaints are innumerable. I must not lose him, Master Dante. We'll rescue him. You miss them, your fellows from the sphere of fixed stars. His Ptolemaic concept of the universe was the most modern available. Galileo wouldn't be born for 2 centuries. We are not as you. We are many in one. When we meet our compatriots again, they will learn all our experiences, and we shall know all they know. So yes, we miss them, but we can easily survive, for all time if need be. Unlike men, you say we say I. And yet humans cannot survive without each other. Our very Catholic faith is communal. Surely the Florentine spoke not of them, but of himself. Centuries are as an oracle had taught, as Medisque, the value of saying nothing. The poet talked enough for them both. You are mortal. Long lived. We are fragile. Hence your vase. What if, having trod the mill of the years, you come to the future date and your fellows do not come? Shall you curse God and die? Then, somehow, we altered. reality, space-time, the continuum, how to say it to a medieval scholar. We altered Clio's scroll. Ah, Clio, the muse of history, you expect them to be there. We shall know if our people communicated with your descendants. If they have not, we will reveal ourselves. And then we shall step forward into that unknown future together. The poet wiped his brow under the edge of the cappuccino. Sartiano's tall wooden gates stood broad open, and the market square beyond was thronged. Executions were an occasion for festivity, youthful, demoniacs rare. I may not enter, the poet said. The warrant for my execution in Florence binds all its allies. Are we in time? Executions are traditionally at sunset. Set me down, then. The poet sat on an old tomb in the shade. He eased the cloth sling from his shoulder and set the heavy clay vase out of casual view. With tiny, effortful jerks, Asmodiske pushed the stopper up out of the narrow neck. For the first time in years, they crept out. Holy and blessed Virgin, the poet breathed. You declared you were not human. But seeing is believing. Humans saw a handful of ropey, restless earthworms, or wet, slippery leather ropes with no central knot. It was not their disgust, Asmodiske dreaded. It was when they were frightened or angry that humans flailed out. But they had chosen wisely. The Florentines' first reaction was intellectual. We've provisionally agreed that you are not a demon. I see now the legends are true, but slantwise. The Cumaean Sibyl indeed fell from the sky in a falling star, another tale that she's very old and is kept in a jar, also fact. Astonishing, but the Sibyl is a calamari. Have you read Dio Cassius? He reports that a well-reputed Roman general and his lieutenant saw flying shields in the sky. The gatekeepers had abandoned their post to see the burning. The clamor meant the prisoner was being brought out. We must go. Take the vase and walk back to the monastery. We'll liberate Ettore and follow. And if I ask how you'll accomplish that, the Florentine grumbled, you'll tell me there are no words. If all goes well, you shall see. If we do not return, nor the boy, at least you shall escape. The poet cocked his head, listening. You'd better hurry. They're chaining him to the stake. Two. It should have been the worst moment. Ettore was certain there'd be plenty of uglier ones soon. His knife was gone, of course, but it had been shocking when they'd snatched cloak, tunic, hose, and shoes. You won't need them for warmth, his jailer had joked. Now he walked to the stake, practically naked, in only the khan undertunic and short breeches. His wrists were tied together, and he held them pressed low to keep the hem from blowing upward. The stake was an iron pole with tinder and logs heaped around it. So young to be damned eternally, the parish priest said. Repent now, boy, while there's time. I know no demons, he declared as they hauled him up. By the blood of Christ, I swear it! Recalcitrant! You were seen, demon lover. The stake was uncomfortably hard against his spine. The guard drew the chain tight around him and joined the links with a twist of wire. Ettore scowled the crowd from under his thick black eyebrows. He must be a piteous sight, bone thin and unclothed. Confess and be saved, the priest pleaded. Will I be freed then? Of course not, but you'll avoid damnation. A flaming iron tomb awaits you in hell. He held back the retort. What a pity that Asmodiske's new owner could not know someone in Sartiano had read the Inferno. Another prelate read off the death sentence in Latin. The last slice of sun lay scarlet on the tile roofs, leaving the marketplace in shadow. The executioner's torch was a bright finger passing through the press. The last few moments of his short life, but Ettore refused to regret it. My forefather was Glaucus, son of Glaucus, he told himself. Of the line of Deiphobe, the Sibyl, in the Aeneid. I have been loyal to the very stake My fathers will greet me in Master Dante's heaven with pride because I gave my life to save the Sibyl. Then he felt it, damp leather touching his bare instep. In the time it took to draw a breath of wonder, it wound rapidly up his leg under the breeches, round his waist and up inside his patched undertunic to his neck. The tiny metallic voice buzzed in his ear. When they thrust the torch into the tinder, shout aloud to your saints. Call upon everyone you can name, loud as you can. To demonstrate his faith? No, to cover Asmodiske's actions. The chain around his waist was loose now. They had untwisted the wire. The rope on his wrists went slack. With an effort, Ettore stood unmoving as the executioner leaned near. The glare of the torch might let him glimpse Asmodiske. One glance would be plenty to prove demonolatry. The torch thrust crackling into the dry fuel. Without moving his lips, Ettore muttered, "He'll see you. He's not moving away." "Probably instructed to strangle you. Pray, now." Before the smoke choked him, Ettore sucked in a breath. His shout was shrill. "Holy Virgin, Mother of Christ, be a mother to me and pluck me out of peril. Bear witness, Saint Lucia, Saint Francis, that I am innocent. Oh, holy Saint John, Saint Michael, Saint Agnes, help me, an innocent child." The priest wrung his hands. The prelate held up a crucifix and the crowd muttered in doubt. This was not how demon worshippers died. He could feel it, the leathery length stretching and shrinking across his skin. So small and weak, Asmodiske could defend themselves. Grandfather had spoken of when the treasury of the oracle in Comai had been looted. 900 years ago. Speed was the secret, Grandfather said, so that Asmodiske could stab 6 inches of probe into a man's ear. Ettore saw nothing but the executioner toppling backward like a cut tree. Before his head hit the cobbles, Asmodiske was out, whipping back into the tall pile of fuel and up around Ettore's legs. Fire would not hurt them, but Ettore could not imagine how this would help. The crowd was too close, stooping over the fallen man with cries of dismay. They wouldn't let him climb down from the pyre and walk away, and Asmodiske had to stay out of sight. It was too smoky to pray aloud anymore. His bare feet were beginning to scorch. The snaky arms gripped him under the arms inside the shirt. Without the slightest warning, Ettore rose out of his bonds up into the air. Could one fall upward? It was not the leap of a deer, nor the beat of wings, but a purely vertical ascent, straight up into the cool evening sky. Between his sooty toes, he glimpsed the rigid tile roofs of the town surrounding the central glow of the pyre. The pallid faces looking up could have been ant eggs, their shouts of astonishment dwindling. His blood was rushing down away from his head. The protest burst from him. "This is too costly!" And everything went black. 3. The boy was too heavy. They no longer had the power to rise, and so they fell. It was difficult to control their descent, and at the same time, seek the Florentine's heat signature. How far could he have walked? Their rise and descent against the lambent blue evening sky had been plain to see. Searchers would be here soon. There, a warmth more than 5 feet high going south. Antigravity was enormously draining. With almost the last of their strength, Asmodiske sank with Ettore into the road at the poet's feet. They were too weak to record his yelp of surprise, the profanity indubitably vulgar and not Latin. "Here," he barked, "your kazovas." Asmodiske crept in and collapsed into the emergency supplies of power. "We are pursued," they warned. "Sweet, yes." He set the vase onto the boy's lap and seized the skinny ankles. Tight, dark curls dragged through the dust as he hauled Ettore off the road. The downhill side was choked with vines and undergrowth, and he shoved vase and boy into it. Then he strolled slowly on, along the Via Cassia, toward San Martino, his hands clasped behind his back. He heard the horses behind him, and then a shout. "You! There! Did you see anything? In the sky?" As if from a distance, Dante blinked up at the mountain men. One of them held a lantern, the glow flicking from face to saddlecloth to sword hilt. "Do I know you, sirs?" His haughty accent was pure Tuscan. The spokesman tempered his tone immediately. "Sir, We pursue a demon who snatched away a prisoner before his execution. There wasn't a demon, another interposed. The boy flew, of himself. He called on the Blessed Virgin to pluck him out. How could that be a demon? A flying boy, Dante mused. How original. No, I saw no boy in the air. Would you take an oath on it?
Certainly.
He's flown to Cianciano by now, somebody grumbled. Their badges were yellow and black, Fanelli's colors. His lordship is away, I take it. I met him in Florence. He is in Perugia. Who shall I tell him you are, sir?
I am traveling to Arvetio, breaking my journey at the Abbey of San Martino. My name is Dante Alighieri.
He watched, unsurprised, as their faces changed in the lantern light.
The poet, the Florentine, the one who visited hell?
One crossed himself, but the man in charge saluted.
Lord Filippo will be sorry to have missed you, sir.
He tried not to be sardonic.
My verse enters where I cannot.
Come, lads, we'll leave Cianciano for tomorrow. They turned north again with a great clatter of hooves. The tender blue twilight was a colorless smear in the west now. The poet walked in the dark as the hoofbeats faded. Slowly the scrape and whir of insects returned. Only when an owl called did he turn back. From the road's verge, he could make out Ettore's pale face among the leaves below.
You lied to me, girl.
I'm sorry, Master Dante, Ettore gasped. But how did you know?
Come up. The monks will bar their doors for the night soon.
Ettore thrashed up the slope burdened by the heavy round vase. The abbey's roof loomed dark above the olive trees not far.
I hauled you off the road by your ankles. There's nothing male in your breeches. Don't shrink like that. I have a daughter. Your name cannot be Ettore. What were you baptized?
Ettore held the vase under one arm and loosened the stopper with the other hand.
Do I have to tell?
The voice from within was weak.
It's quite ordinary. Many women have it.
Your name, girl?
My name, it's Beatrice, of the Glaucol clan.
He would have held on to his anger, but couldn't restrain a bark of laughter.
Do you fear I'll be confused?
I'll address you as Bice.
What? No, it sounds like a dog.
Again, he wavered between irritation and humor.
Ettore was the defender of Troy and Homer. Ippolita, equally classical, that would suit you.
Perhaps. She spoke with stern dignity, but he saw teeth flash white and a reluctant smile.
When the King of Naples' armies sacked the town, my grandfather had me wear boys' clothes. To escape rape and murder? Good. I've been a Ettore since I was 9.
Robert the Wise campaigned in 1307, he calculated. So you're not yet 12?
Merciful saints. We hid in Asmodiske's cave, but afterward, Cumae was rubble. So we went to Rome, where Grandfather copied manuscripts, and I wrote letters for people. But in the city, we couldn't hide Asmodiske.
They need energy.
Not food.
Heat. The hot gases at Cumae in ancient times were ideal, but they diminished. When Grandfather died, I'd realized I'd probably die too, and then what would happen to Asmodiske? I had to find someone to give them to. I thought about the Pope.
Clement V, he spat his contempt, that lawless shepherd.
He moved the papacy to Avignon. It's too far. And priests worry about demons even more than you. Henry VII, the Holy Roman Emperor, he would have been perfect. So I walk north, but now he's besieging Brescia.
Holy Mary, you'd walk into an armed camp.
No, it's too dangerous near the fighting, and he won't come south until next year.
But then you heard that I was nearby?
I hope you don't mind. Her voice grew thick with tears.
You are wise. You understand they're not a monster or a demon. I knew it would be impossible for me to keep them secret. I have no money, no home, no way to keep them alive. And now they've spent so much energy to rescue me, they'll die.
A thread of lamplight showed the abbey gate was still open.
Despair is a sin, Ippolita.
11 is too young to indulge in it. Let's go in.
prospects will seem brighter after supper.
4. The poet urged his overloaded mule into motion.
"Don't pinch," he growled. "You may grip the Luco, but not my person."
"I shall, thank you." Riding Pillion behind him was better than walking. Ippolita tried to feel grateful, even though she had to sit sideways, as a female should. Asmodiske's vase was slung on the top of a saddlebag at her back, where the sun could pour down onto the censers they had cautiously spread out.
"This is the safest time to lay out your story," the poet said. "We cannot be overheard. I disliked having to tell the good abbot last night that you were my secretary's sister's daughter who I'd foolishly agreed to escort to our vitio."
"How did you find me linens and a gown?"
"I told him you'd been robbed just before I met you. Since the Franciscans are a mendicant order, they have a store of donated clothing."
She was impressed. "You're a good liar," he corrected her.
"Creative."
"You're a genuine necromancer?"
"The inferno is allegory. Your Campanian accent must be accounted for. Therefore, from this moment, you're Ippolita Napolitana, Ippolita of Naples. Since Ettore was a boy flying north, the girl Ippolita riding south should be safe enough."
"Very well.
And what you shall do now that you are not burned at the stake?"
"Asmodiske must be cared for."
"Why?"
"Because they are rare and foreign and full of knowledge. If the task is too onerous for you, give them back to me and I'll find someone else."
"Is the creature your pet then? A long-lived donk or donkey that your family has maintained for years?"
"Of course not."
She cocked her head, listening to the tiny buzz in the vase.
"Speak up, creature."
She defended them.
"They used all their stored power, a year or more of hoarded heat, to rescue me."
"Perhaps it is you who are the pet. All your family slaves, generation after generation of faithful hounds trained to die and save an inhuman master."
"You make it sound so nasty."
"Life as a boy has made you inappropriately argumentative."
"It's not argument if it's true."
"What benefit did your ancestors drive from this responsibility?"
"They're the Sibyl of Cumae. And I'm, like my forefathers, repeating and interpreting their mutterings to you."
"Then tell your own future, Asmodiske. What shall we do with you? What is your fate?"
The tiny metallic voice was barely audible. "Isn't fortune-telling deplored in your holy book?"
"The devil knows scripture. Or did you read Deuteronomy here?"
"They knew the Bible when they came," Ippolita said. "They know everything, but they don't always tell."
The mule slowed to a shamble as the poet's attention shifted. "A new idea. Perhaps Asmodiske and all their companions are angels. Or the souls of the blessed and redeemed descending from the sphere of fixed stars."
"It's possible." He had too many ideas. "We don't recall being either an angel or a redeemed soul," Asmodiske whispered. "How does one tell?"
"A good question, never addressed so far as I know, but ha, I have the solution. Let us take Asmodiske to Bologna."
"Is there a volcanic vent there?"
"Not at the university, which is the oldest center of learning in Europe. The scholars there may talk to Asmodiske, decant all their knowledge, write it down for study."
"Oh, it's perfect.
From Orvieto, we shall return to Ravenna, so that I may report to Guido da Polenta, who'll be in Bologna before winter."
The poet nudged the mule into motion again. Asmodiske spoke up so clearly that Ippolita knew that they were worried.
"Master Dante, we spoke of Clio's scroll."
"You did?"
Ippolita straightened.
"Asmodiske, you trusted him so far?"
"Envision the scroll of history, century after century running from the beginning of time to the end."
The poet frowned over his right shoulder at the vase. "And this is the 14th century.
We didn't arrive here, on this page of the scroll."
"Of course not. The Cumaean Sibyl was there before the Roman Republic."
"We arrived in 2023, over 700 years from now."
"The 21st century."
By craning her neck, Ippolita could glimpse
poet's lean cheek and lantern jaw slack with astonishment.
You are not going forward to meet them there. You were there with them. And then,
as Medisque's voice slowly faded, it was a time of tension, of war. Your descendants shot arrows into the sky as we descended. A fire arrow struck us. There was an enormous noise and shock. We were struck down or aside or through, swept back into the scroll many pages earlier, to when Rome was ruled by kings.
The mule halted because the poet had let the reins go slack.
And now your doom is to trudge forward slowly day by day and year by year from that early page to the proper one where your fellow shall be.
Exactly.
And thus you come by your knowledge of the future naturally and not by demonic magic.
Yes. Is this important? Hippolyta demanded.
Of course it is, girl. Asmodiske reminds us that fortune-telling is forbidden, but now we can assure the professori at Bologna that it shall not be a sin to plump their knowledge, which suggests a corollary. Asmodiske, there is a question I will not ask. Since it is not a sin, tell me the answer.
Hippolyta scowled. The poet had worked out how to ask the oracle a question without involving her. The answer is no. She could feel it sitting at the back, shyly gripping the slack of his luco. In the blazing August sunshine, the poet shivered. Master, are you all right? He drew in a shaky breath.
I'm well, thank you. He kicked the mule into motion. Liar. She listened at the mouth of the vase.
They say you knew the answer before you asked.
Perhaps they are a demon after all. The devil is a liar. The professori shall test the theory.
Why was he angry?
No, the tiny voice struggled to be louder.
Remember, we spoke of changing the world. Our presence must not disrupt history. Our only hope of meeting our fellows is to refrain from altering Clio's scroll.
The page, when I arrive there, must be the same page that I left.
The savants at the university would write letters and treatises.
They shall not keep our existence secret. We cannot go to Bologna.
She stuck to the main issue. And how shall Asmodiske stay alive?
You gave them to me, the poet retorted. It's for me to decide, and Bologna is our destination.
Then I take them back, Hippolyta snapped. You are no fit keeper.
A hard kick knocked his left foot out of the stirrup. She gripped him around the body and threw herself backward, pulling them both out of the saddle. He crashed into the dust beneath her, and she vaulted up and back into the saddles in a single grasshopper leap.
Wait! Dante spat dust. That mule isn't mine. It belongs to Da Polenta.
Vaffanculo!
With one hand, she made figs at him. The shocking vulgarity stunned him for a moment. She slapped the mule's rump, but the beast had no turn for speed. He lunged in a last desperate grab at a baggage strap. The bag came away in his hand, but the vase fell with it. He tumbled backward into the road, the rolled hat flying, catching the clay handle loop just in time to keep it from smashing. She didn't look back.
Ha! He panted in triumph. A sharp sally, but on balance, I think I've won the skirmish. What do you foresee, creature? Are you shaken to pieces in there? When she notices you're gone, she shall return for you, or flee.
The voice wavered, barely audible.
She's loyal to the death. She'll return.
Hungry. This is the food bag.
Fortunate.
Almost, he laughed. Do not attribute my triumph to skill. He picked up his fallen hat. Beyond the curve of the road, a stream rushed down the mountainside. He set bag and vase under a tree and went to wash. Sitting beside the vase, he could hear the metallic whisper better.
Master Dante, do you still have your purse?
What? He felt for it. Yes, inside my tunic. Wait, do you suggest she's a pickpocket?
She survived walking from Naples to Tuscany by stealing for food. Do you recall why the King of Naples raised Cumae?
It had become a nest of bandits, I heard.
The chief of those bandits was her uncle. They hanged him.
Mother of heaven.
When the church closed the oracle, the Glauco clan turned to robbery.
Until the authorities could tolerate them no more, I see.
The apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
Uncle Lorenzo taught her how to hijack riding animals.
Hence her dexterity kicking him off his own mount. She said that they supported themselves by the pen in Rome.
By day, by night, old Glauco was a housebreaker.
He took a loaf of bread from the bag and broke off a piece. How did he perish?
They captured him and applied the penalty.
Cut off his hand.
Yes. The wound turned mortal. Now alone to support us. Polita became a thief. In another year she'll be ripe for prostitution. We don't fear she'll starve. We fear she'll die a criminal's death on a gibbet. She must get shed of us, Master Dante. So young, the burden of sustaining us crushes her.
Only when he reached for the knife at his belt to carve off a chunk of pecorino did he discover the sheath empty. A pickpocket indeed. Damn her. She lifted my knife. Why do you want to save her? She's, as she said of me, positively nasty.
Her family has served us faithfully for centuries. How can we let her, the last of the line, perish? We hoped that you, a wise and good man, could help her as we cannot.
Wise and good, huh?
You are famously eloquent, persuasive.
He munched bread, eking it out with bites of the hard cheese. This is not the behavior of the master directing a slave. Perhaps she and her Criminius clan before her rules you. A tribe of bandits seizing upon a helpless, undersized creature fallen from the sky, making a living by pandering knowledge of the future as an oracle. One of your great difficulties is that you're small. A mere double handful that fits into an oil amphora. An easy victim. In his Poetics, Aristotle said that a very small animal organism cannot be beautiful. Your troubles would be less if you were big as a lion.
The disposition of power, who has it and who does not, fascinates you.
A man, powerless, is painfully sensitive to it. He frowned at the round vase. Nearly all of its original decoration was worn away, but it might have been an octopus. That was certainly a painted tentacle near the neck, a bleak proof of the creature's tail. You've studied men for centuries. Can you predict what I shall do from day to day, moment to moment?
Clio's scroll isn't writ so small. I know the large things, the death of emperors. Listen.
Only when it twitched did he perceive the flat tendril peeping over the clay lip.
She comes.
The mule ambled into view, the girl in the saddle with her skirts hitched immodestly high. When she glimpsed him, she reined in.
Asmodiske, she called.
He observed now her thinness, not to the point of famine. The curly dark hair was still thick enough to fight the comb, but she'd gone hungry for some while. Come and eat, and let the beast drink. The mule dipped its nose into the stream.
You're not angry?
I want my knife to slice this pecorino. He held out a hunk of bread. When was the last time you had enough to eat?
Last night was the first since Easter. Lentils with fennel and sausage.
She slid out of the saddle and edged closer.
It was just that you must not take them to Bologna. They are masters of their fate.
She set her teeth, a gesture that unexpectedly twisted his heart.
And so am I.
Nothing shall be done against their will or yours. Eloquence was a kind way to put it. Words, the very breath of his soul, had kept him alive through the years of exile. Child, the creature has told me everything. You cannot go on this way, transmuting into a wild thing as thieves did in my poem. Cunningly, he added, Asmodiske shall grieve if you end as your elders did. A tear rolled down her sunburned nose. She sat down with a thump.
I don't want to. I hate being by myself trying to manage. I wish everyone hadn't died.
From the neck of the vase, a long, thin strap gently slipped down onto her fingers. We're glad you came back. He tossed the bread into her lap. It goes down better with cheese. Pass me the knife. After slicing it, he returned the blade to his belt. Behold, now, I consult you. We agree something must change. What shall we do with you? The second time he'd asked that question today. She accepted the offered cheese.
Asmodiske said, Master Dante, could we join your household?
I have none. If I could return to Florence. But I'm homeless myself, living upon the patronage of wealthy noblemen. I'm sponsored on this journey by Da Polenta to negotiate a compromise about salt taxes. I cannot ask him to maintain a girl on my behalf. Who'd trust a diplomat of dissolute habit? Also, my wife would have some sharp things to say. She took another piece of pecorino. Perhaps you should just give the sibyl back to me again. What, wash my hands like Pilate? No. At least you may travel under my protection for a time. I must be in Orvieto by week's end. A better notion may come to us there, he remembered to say. Do you agree, Ippolita? She glared at him from under the thick brows. If I need to run away, I'll take your knife. One meal was fuel enough for defiance. Amazing. You shall not need to run away. 5. I could marry a robber baron and help him terrorize Tuscany. The poet's deep voice resonated in his cloaked back, close beside her. I'd report you and your putative husband to the authorities. You know where betrayers of friends go to, she retorted. In the ice, deep at the bottom of your inferno. Your taste in poetry is superb. This was not a man who laughed often, but he might be hiding it. What if I marry a baker? Then Asmodiske could be nourished upon the heat of the bake oven. They're dying, and we're poking along like this. The warmth of the sun isn't enough, even at summer's height. She held the vase on her lap by the rim. Last night, the tiny metallic voice in the vase had fallen silent. Oh, please, holy Saint Francis, not forever. But as long as a flat thread of tentacle wrapped around her finger, she knew Asmodiske still lived. Have they not been a blight, a curse, once strong and numerous? Serving the creature has made your family dwindle. You're the sole survivor. That was Robert of Naples, the stronzo. You shall wish to moderate your speech. That imaginary baker will never wed a girl with so foul a tongue. He'd planned to halt at Setona, but yesterday the gate of that village had been shut tight. From within came the tolling of the church bell, signaling that plague was abroad. They had slept inside a hay shed, and now her clothes were itchy with bits of straw. She surveyed the next village up on its crag with distaste. At a distance, the foot of the cliff looked like a broken rock. Nearer, they were ruins, a tumble of broken white marble pavements. Laundry lines were strung between broken columns, stables and sheds leaned against the remnants of walls, and low places were drowned in green water. Dante recognized them. Antique fountains, or perhaps baths. When he dismounted, she had to descend too. He led their mount to a marble channel, but the mule snorted at it. An old man put his head out from a shed.
They won't drink. It tastes bad.
Dante's ready address struck her as folly. This is San Casciano, is it not?
San Casciano de Bagni. You're here for the night marker. You'll be wanting to stable your mule.
Perhaps. Tell me of these waters. I can see our forefathers use them.
They took baths. Augustus Caesar bathed here. There are 40 of them. Hot springs to soothe your ailments.
Before she could protest, the poet had made the bargain and unstrapped the saddlebags. We can't waste time on bathing. Asmodiske is dying. The poet looked down, his long, narrow nose at her.
Did you hear what the old fellow said? The waters are hot. How hot? Your friend needs a constant source of heat. What hot water do?
I don't know. She had to admit it was a good idea. I could try.
Good. The woman's bathing pool is that way.
Many feet had smoothed the path over the broken marble pavement. It turned a corner and ended in a large rectangular pool, only a few feet deep. The bottom was thick with unfamiliar greenish weed. Water flowed in from a broad stone channel and out through a lower channel at the other end. So late in the afternoon, the only other bathers were two women at the farther end struggling to wash a screaming child. She sat down on the marble verge and dipped her feet in. It was deliciously, surprisingly warm. She murmured into the mouth of the vase, "It's not boiling hot, but it's warmer than sunshine on pottery."
She lowered the vase onto a shallow spot. The water came halfway up the curving side. Asmodiske relaxed their grip on her fingers, and she saw a flat appendage slide up over the rim and down into the water. Satisfied, she pulled the cheap cotton gown over her head and the kerchief with it. Since she had only one under tunic, she took that off as well and quickly sat down to hide her nakedness. The water came up to her chin. Itchy chaff and hayseeds floated away. She sighed in bliss and ducked her curly dark head under. The ancients might be right. The waters were healing. She loitered so long that Dante had to shout for her from the corner. He had changed his clothes. Under the dark luco, he wore a rosato red robe. She bristled. Why are you so fine? Many people shall be at the night market, and I must make a respectable appearance. I have a notion that Asmodiske should hear, if they're able. He peered into the neck of the vase. The tiny voice was stronger.
I, too, have a notion. The warm water helped,
Ippolita exclaimed.
A pool opened to the sky, Asmodiske said. Fed by water flowing through open trenches, it is warm. But what if we went closer to the source?
It would be hotter, she bounced with joy. A maze of stone-lined channels branched through vegetable plots and wandered in and out of ruins. But water flows downhill. They climbed up to where the land was too steep to till. Trees clustered close at the base of the cliff as high as a house, more than vertical. An enormous oak tree guarded a spring. Heavy boughs drooped low over where the water gushed out from under a stone edge shadowed by a muscular root. The poet dipped a hand into the rushing flow and snatched his fingers back.
You could poach a fish in it,
she set the vase down.
Can you breathe water?
Asmodiske extruded a long appendage.
If there be warmth enough, yes.
There were not words to tell of their native habitat, deep under alien seas where gases roared eternally up from hydrothermal vents. The lesser terrestrial heart flowed gloriously into every millimeter of them. Suddenly, they could think, speak, access systems grayed out for years. Quickly, they surveyed the data. This was a tectonically active region, yes, but the water would flow for centuries yet, its heat only slowly diminishing.
We can hide here, possibly until our friends come.
The poet gazed into the roiling waters.
For 700 years.
Ippolita, Ettore, Beatrice. Smash the vase.
Your home? Asmodiske, are you sure?
Yes.
She bit her lip. With trembling hands, she lifted the ancient clay vase by one looped handle. When she let it fall, the thick pottery refused to shatter. The poet picked it up and slammed it with more strength against the stone. The vase broke into jagged fragments. They both gasped. Liquid silver splashed out at their feet, but it didn't drip. It cohered, clinging, but infinitely flexible as Asmodiske was flexible within it. Garment, armor, or dwelling, it flowed with them, down into the hot stream and then up against the current, under the root and the ledge of rock, out of sight. The poet sighed a breath of wonder.
It's gone. No.
She blinked away tears and pointed at the strand, thin as a straw clinging to the edge of the rock.
They still here. Don't you, Asmodiske? Yes. This is the refuge we sought. Brave Beatrice, you have been good and faithful. Be free now of us. But at need, we will always answer you, last and best of the guardians of the Oracle of Kumei.
Tears ran hot as a spring down her cheeks, but she held her voice steady.
I'll come back, Asmodiske.
That was all. The end. She would have flung herself to the ground to sob, but it was too steep and stony. She cried for an uncounted time. Only gradually did she notice he had taken her arm, guiding her down out of the woods, around the cliff, and up the winding road to the gates. The poet talked all the way, persuasively. Logically.
The last remnant of your home, your family, your people, your grief is natural. Farewells are bitter, but you must now change your life, girl. I cannot keep you, and
You cannot keep yourself. My notion was a convent, a safe haven for you.
A convent? No.
There's no other respectable refuge for a female, Ippolita. I see now my view of your plight was too small, too worldly. It's larger and simpler. You love the creature, and the creature loved you a pure affection, like the ones in heaven. You were willing to lay down your life for them, and they assuredly nearly died to save you. Because they love you, they wish you to be safe and happy. Because you love them, you ought to try. See? Here we are. What odds would you give that there's a convent in San Casciano? Would that not be a comfort to be close to Asmodiske's new hiding place? Death would be preferable. She eyed the gate, looking for footholds. The heat of the day lessened when the sun dipped behind the hill. Suddenly, it was pleasant to be outdoors. The night market was set up near the top of the village, in the church square. Cressets and lanterns cast a festive light. Men sat on benches, sipping wine. A juggler circulated through the crowd, and someone had a dancing dog. Booths at the edges sold vegetables, embroidery, and marzipan in lurid colors. The poet made straight for the apothecary stall. She had not realized that apothecaries here also sold books and paper. This booth had jars of ointment and powders at the front, but also quires of paper, goose quills, and bottles of ink. Worn mice-nibbled volumes stood on the sill at the back. Without a word, he selected one, sat down, and began to read. Ippolita wiped her nose on her sleeve. If she wanted to escape, she'd need money. A crowded market was the ideal place to lift a purse or a pouch.
Would you like a honeyed almond?
She stared at the woman's coarse gray linen smock and veil.
Are you a nun?
Yes, I'm Sister Felicita. I can give you one almond to taste. More, you must buy.
She held out a spoon. Ippolita took its single almond. It tasted better than oranges, better than pure honey even.
Oh, it's delicious.
2 ounces for a denaro.
Perhaps later.
Although to steal a purse here and then return to buy sweets was imprudent. She can read and write, the poet turned a page. Clever child. Supported her family by writing letters. May I ask, Sister Felicita, what is your convent?
We are Benedictine, the Sisters of the Holy Conception.
And does your convent accept charity boarders? She founded Ippolita.
Your daughter?
No. He closed the book and set it back on the windowsill. I found her starving on the road and was moved to charity.
What were you baptized, girl?
She scowled at him from under her eyebrows. My name is Beatrice. Unoffended, the poet rose. Cut a pen, Beatrice, and you may demonstrate your writing. From the jar on the shelf, he pulled a goose quill. Sister Felicita offered a penknife.
We far prefer some financial support for our boarders, sir. What is your name?
I am Dante Alighieri.
The nun didn't recognize it. Her eye assessed his fine red robe.
15 florins yearly is the minimum fee, and she may earn the rest of her keep with her needle.
Beatrice sliced viciously at the quill. I can't sew. A lie, but since every female could sew, this should be instantly repellent. Unperturbed, the poet said, she could write letters for the illiterate. Find a piece of paper, good sister, and she'll demonstrate. The nun turned away to rummage for a scrap. Beatrice hissed,
I'll blot it and misspell.
The poet's reply was grave. You're young, Beatrice. In you resides the hope of the future. I'm old. Asmodiske, older yet. We know we can't change the world because we tried and failed, and so we must save you because it's your task.
To change the world?
For you, Clio's scroll is yet to be written. Write it, Beatrice. Write it better. The sky was entirely dark now, but the marketplace was bright, and dimly she saw it. She had a future, her own path that didn't involve Asmodiske. Uncle or grandfather, or even the poet. If she didn't grasp it, that brighter future would never be known.
Here, a bill of lading. She can use the back.
The nun set down paper and inkwell. Take ink, girl. I'll go slowly. He leaned an elbow on the herb rack at the front of the booth and spoke. No, declaimed, not loudly, but in a strong, supple voice that carried to every ear. Beatrice's pen scraped across the page as fast as she could drive it. Midway upon the journey of our life, I found myself within a forest dark, where the straightforward pathway had been lost. Ah, me, how hard a thing it is to say. What was this forest savage, rough and stern, which in the very thought renews the fear? So bitter is it, death is little more. But of the good to treat, which there I found, speak will I of the other things I saw there. The page was filled, but he didn't stop, swept along by his own verse. Beatrice listened, eyes wide. Out past the rack of drying herbs, ointments, and inks, the market's revelers gathered to listen to verse not in Latin, but in their own tongue. Mothers hushed their children, men craned their necks, and a pool of silence spread, filled only with the poet's voice. Out at the verge, she could hear them. Shush! It's Dante. He visited hell. At the end of the canto, he stopped. Let me see, girl. There's an I in variegated. You had better insert it. The nun closed her mouth, which had dropped open. Sir, that was astonishing. Master Dante. The young man pushing forward wore doublet and hose of fine cloth, and his mantle was blue silk. I recognized your voice, but I cannot hope that you will remember me. Girlandio di Ventura. I attended your lectures in Bologna. Di Ventura, of course I remember. She was certain he didn't, but the words were utterly convincing. Lectures on the theory of vernacular language. I wonder anyone stayed awake. What are you doing in San Casciano?
I'm secretary to the village's podesta, Sir Tancredi di Visconti del Campiglia. May I present you?
Before he could do it, an impatient old crusader knight stepped forward, a large black hat with trailing lappets perched on his head. And his chioppa was opulently pleated and greed brocade. He thrust a plump hand out.
An honor, Master Dante. The descendant of genius from on high. What the devil is such a poet doing, reciting immortal verse in the marketplace? You must come to dinner. A hostel, shameful. Accept my hospitality, I insist. Di Ventura. Let someone run up to the castle. Warn Alessandra to make up the beds. Have the butler invite the town fathers.
Beatrice crammed the cork back into the ink bottle. She was being left again. Asmodiske had had no choice but to go where they could live, but the poet would be off with his grand friends. Just as well. This convent wouldn't take in a penniless postulant. The moment he turned his back, she'd slip out through the crowd, helping herself to any unguarded valuables on the way. But suddenly they were inside the booth.
Literacy must be fostered, and when I learned her name was Beatrice, I felt it was heaven's imprimatur. Of course, Di Ventura lifted the page with the fastidious fingertips in case the ink was still wet. A decent Carolingian, minuscule indeed.
Sir Tancredi peered short-sightedly at it.
This, your very words. I'll buy it. It's not fit, sir, the poet interposed. Writ on waste paper, misspelled. Note it in the margin, girl, that consternation has an R in the middle.
Let Beatrice copy it again, fair on a clean page, Sir Tancredi. Then it will be worthy of you. And sister, Felicita, are you familiar with the term right to copy? I give to Beatrice the right to copy this canto in her own hand, as often as she finds it profitable.
Her dowry, Di Ventura handed the sheet back. That's wildly generous of you, master.
A single canto, no. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give.
Consider it as the single almond that the good sister offers, a sample to whet appetite.
Sir Tancredi immediately proved it worked.
I have no copy of the Inferno, Master Dante. Tell me the name of your copyist.
Di Ventura said. I'll write to him tomorrow.
Clever, she murmured.
The poet eyed her. You did well, but judging from your spelling, you've never read the poem, have you? She twiddled the goose quill. Almost, he laughed. A negative reply to that question is not rare.
Orvieto,
Sir Tancredi said. Huh, you must be helping with the debate about Pisa's damnable salt taxes.
Expensive robes rustled as they departed. Sister Felicita stared at the paper as if it were fine gold.
Well, it's not settled yet, but to keep Sir Tancredi waiting is never wise. Certainly, Beatrice, we can readily sell your copies of Master Dante's first canto.
Beatrice met the nun's eye. The convent supplies ink and paper. I buy the pens. We divide the money.
Six. He was too old now to sleep rough, the poet reflected. Better a grand supper and slumber in a soft bed between linen sheets. Sir Tancredi had insisted on lending him horses, Di Ventura, as an escort and a groom. But Dante expressed a wish to make his devotions before they set out. From the castle, dawn over the Paglia Valley lifted the heart, honey-colored light poured over a vista of olive groves, prosperous fields, and lush vineyards. The morning air was cool when he walked past the village gates and around to where the trees guarded the hot spring. He spoke with confidence.
You declared that you would heed Beatrice's call.
I invoke you in her name. Answer, Asmodiske. He noted the leathery strand, tucked into a crevice of the rock. Metallic voice rang out stronger than he'd ever heard it.
Florentine.
She's taken refuge in the village in the convent of the Sisters of the Holy Conception.
They did not exaggerate your powers of persuasion.
Doubtless, she'll come down soon to complain bitterly about it. Discourage her, if you would, from running away.
A convent. Was that not costly?
Mine hosts the lord of the village, had all his friends to dinner last night, and I called upon them to contribute a florin or two from a dozen merchants with literary pretensions, and it's paid for this year at least.
You are kind to come tell me.
No, creature. I have a question for the Sibyl of Cumae. Beatrice is not here, so I may ask aloud. Shall I return to Florence?
The pause was long enough for him to hear the oak leaves rustle.
No.
He recognized the reflexive anger of a proud and willful man, balked of his purpose. Who but he should know his besetting sins? And yet he retorted,
I know your secrets. Do you not fear I shall tell them, write them? I know everything you have ever written or will write, Master Dante. Remember, I have Clio's scroll. You do not betray me.
It is not my free will, then. I could betray you, destroy your future many pages ahead in the scroll.
You wish me to threaten you.
The anger was gone as suddenly as it had come, as temptations do when resisted. His reply was mild.
Only in the cause of plumbing your powers.
Tell me, little creature, I'm curious. What is the worst you could do?
Knowledge is a good weapon for the small, Florentine. Suppose I were to recite to you the poem you are now contemplating. The Purgatorio will exist, but I could rip away from you all the pleasure you shall have in composing it.
His stomach chilled.
That's hellish.
And we agreed I am no demon. I wish you only well, Master Dante. You have helped my dear Beatrice. In return, I will tell your future.
He stood riveted, struck silent as the metallic voice pronounced his doom.
On Clio's scroll, you are writ large. I know all your works, Dante, because you stand with Homer and Virgil, one of humankind's greatest poets. And more than earth, we shall carry your words home with us.
He blew out a breath he had not noticed he was holding.
Ah, my thanks, Asmodiske, for both prophecies.
Knowledge is power, indeed.
Since I shall never return, I'll call my wife out of her family's home in Florence to join me. And from Homer on, fame is the dream of all who labor with the pen.
May your God bless you, Master Dante, and keep you in your travels.
There was nothing in the inhuman voice, but he could hear, like an echo in the clay jar, a knowledge they would not tell. Wise, he did not ask.
Come safe, Asmodiske, to where and when you hope to arrive.
Di Ventura waited at the bottom of the hill with the horses that would carry them swiftly to Orvieto. He must have been smiling because Di Ventura said,
Your prayers were heard, master. Perhaps inspiration for the purgatory cantiche.
No, and yes. He stood unmoving as it surged over him. An idea, a secret history, even as written, riddled through and through with other actors and unwritten ones. Prophecies true, but slantwise. The young hero, the thread through the labyrinth. His name would be Ettore, soldier and heir to Priam, loyal to the death and defense of his city. The poet gripped a hard green nut of nascent verse that, properly tended, might grow tall. The horses stamped, fretting to be gone. The groom held the stirrup, and he sprang to the saddle.
There's something inspiring about the name Beatrice. But let me first finish my comedy.
What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment or a question over at the Clarkesworld Magazine website itself. That's Clarkesworld with an E. We have a few more stories left for you for the month of July. I do hope you can come back and listen, should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and very temporary farewell.